Man and Woman, He Created Them, A Theology of the Body, written by Pope John Paul II. Translation, Introduction, and Index by Michael Waldstein. Narrated by Cathryn Zoe Gowen. From the Archives, the beginning of John Paul II's instructions for the theology of the body. General Instructions and TOB 1. See Introduction. Ad Majorem Dei Gloriam. 1. Totus Tus. To the greater glory of God, all yours. 1. The text Theology of the Body, Part 1, Christ Appeals to the Beginning, divided into 22 discourses, reflections, for the Wednesday audiences. 2. The small additions do not in any way extend, nor do they change, the original structure of the text. They are rather interludes that make it easier, at the same time, to keep the continuity of the topic. I have limited myself in them to the minimum necessary. It may be that some new circumstances will make it necessary in the future to extend these additions, but for the present, there is no need. 3. The notes are to be published together with the corresponding sections. I asked Signora Emilia, Ehrlich, OSU, that we once again revise them. 4. The beginning of the cycle is intended for September 5th, unless some substantive reason makes it necessary to postpone this date. Ad Majorem Dei Gloriam. 1. Totus Tus Ego Sum. To the greater glory of God, I am all yours. General Audience, September 5th. 1. 1. For some time now, preparations have been underway for the next ordinary assembly of the Synod of Bishops, which will take place in Rome in the fall of next year. The topic of the Synod, De Muneribus Familiae Christianae, the duties of the Christian family, will focus our attention on this community of human and Christian life, which has been fundamental from the beginning. The Lord Jesus used precisely this phrase from the beginning in the dialogue about marriage reported in the Gospels of Matthew and Mark. We want to ask ourselves what this word beginning means. In addition, we want to clarify why Christ appeals to the beginning. In this particular circumstance, and for this reason, we look more precisely at the relevant text of sacred scripture. 2. Twice, as in the text. 3. 4. Christ's interlocutors today. 5. During the following Wednesday reflections at the general audiences, we will try, as Christ's interlocutors today, to dwell at greater length on these words from Matthew 19. To follow the indication Christ put into them, we will try to penetrate into the Jesus and Maria, 2. E omnia me tua sun. And all that is mine is yours. Beginning to which he appealed, in such a significant way, and in this way, to follow from afar the great work, italics first added, then deleted, on this topic, that the participants in the next ordinary assembly, synod of bishops, are undertaking right now. Together with the bishops, many groups of pastors and lay people are participating in it, who feel a particular responsibility for the tasks that Christ gives to marriage and to the Christian family. The tasks he has always given and gives also in our epoch, in the contemporary world. The cycle of reflections we are beginning today, with the intention of continuing it during the following Wednesday meetings, has, among others, the goal of accompanying, so to speak, from afar, the work in preparation for the synod, not, however, by directly touching its topic, but by turning attention to the deep roots from which this topic springs. Foreword. The heritage of John Paul II is amazing in its richness and variety. Nevertheless, it has a clear center, the theology of marriage and the family, and the pastoral commitment shaped by this theology. As a young priest, I learned to love human love. If one loves human love, there naturally arises the need to commit oneself completely to the service of fair love, because love is fair, it is beautiful. John Paul II, Crossing the Threshold of Hope, 123. Man and woman, he created them, a theology of the body, is the main expression of this commitment to the beauty of love in John Paul II's teaching. Cardinal Wojtyła wrote the text before his election as Bishop of Rome and originally gave it the title, Male and Female, He Created Them, Genesis 1:27. Reflection about creation stands at the very heart of his argument, as this title suggests. An alternate title given to the work by its author is Human Love in the Divine Plan. God's designs for the person, the designs of divine love for human love, this is the reality the theology of the body attempts to unfold on the basis of the teaching of Jesus. As a philosopher, Wojtyła was clearly aware of the objections brought against the doctrine of creation in the modern era, ever since Descartes and his scientific rationalism. In Love and Responsibility, 1960, Wojtyła points out the habit widespread among intellectuals of confusing the order of nature with the biological order. The term biological order, he argues, does indeed mean the same as the order of nature, but only insofar as this is accessible to the methods of empirical and descriptive natural science, and not as a specific order of existence, with an obvious relationship to the first cause, to God the Creator, 56-57. Biology has man for its immediate author, since man abstracts certain elements from a larger and richer reality. The order of nature, by contrast, includes all these richer relationships among real beings. If one replaces the order of nature with the biological order, the consequences are devastating. My soul had for a long time now been used to seeing in nature nothing but a dead desert covered by a veil of beauty worn by nature like a mask that deceives. Sergei Bugakov. John Paul II's mature 1994 statement of the problem of this split between person and nature puts the matter in a nutshell. The philosopher who formulated the principle of cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am, also gave the modern concept of man its distinctive dualistic character. It is typical of rationalism to make radical contrast in man between spirit and body, between body and spirit. But man is a person in the unity of his body and his spirit. The body can never be reduced to mere matter. The human family is facing the challenge of a new Manichaeism, which body and spirit are put in radical opposition. The body does not receive life from the spirit, and the spirit does not give life to the body. Man thus ceases to live as a person and a subject. Regardless of all intentions and declarations to the contrary, he becomes merely an object. This neo-Manichaean culture has led, for example, to human sexuality being regarded more as an area for manipulation and exploitation than as the basis of that primordial wonder which led Adam on the morning of creation to exclaim before Eve, "This, at last, is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh." Genesis 2:23. This same wonder is echoed in the words of the Song of Solomon. "You have ravished my heart, my sister, my bride, you have ravished my heart with a glance of your eyes." Song of Solomon 4:9. John Paul II, Letter to Families, 19. It is one of the chief merits of Professor Waldstein's extensive introduction that it presents John Paul II's critique of scientific rationalism and his affirmation of the goodness of the body in detail. It may seem strange to some, but it is in fact that, in his theology of the body, the Bishop of Rome upholds the dignity and truth of the bridegroom's cry of joy against scientific rationalism. The beauty of the body, which is the cause of this cry of joy, is not a mere veil, a deceptive mask behind which one must see the prosaic scientific truth of a mere chance mechanism that has no intrinsic meaning. The beauty is real and reliable. Its light can be traced back to God's original guiding intention for man and woman. Human reason can apprehend this light and see the deep reasonableness of God's design. The Catholic tradition has always upheld human reason. In John Paul II's Theology of the Body, it upholds human reason in the ordinary experience of spousal love between man and woman. You have ravished my heart, my sister, my bride. You have ravished my heart with a glance of your eyes. One of the main goals of the Theology of the Body is the defense of Paul VI's prophetic encyclical Humanae Vitae. The defense must be seen in the context of John Paul II's defense of the ordinary human experience of love and its reasonableness. The teachings of Humanae Vitae, as John Paul II understands it, is based on the spousal meaning of the human body, that is, on the God-given power of the body to be a sign of the radical gift of self between man and woman. On the basis of his defense of ordinary human reason in the experience of love between man and woman, John Paul II unfolds a theological argument that is in many respects new in Catholic magisterial teaching. Allow me to mention three of his striking theses. The image of God is found in man and woman above all in the communion of love between them, which reflects the communion of love between the persons of the Trinity. TOB 9:3. In God's design, the spousal union of man and woman is the original effective sign through which holiness entered the world. TOB 19:5. This visible sign of marriage in the beginning is connected with the visible sign of Christ's spousal love for the Church and is thus the foundation of the whole sacramental order. TOB 95b 7. These and the many related theses contained in the Theology of the Body will occupy theologians for a long time and lead to a renewal of theology as a whole. As Professor Waldstein shows in his introduction, John Paul II's teaching, even if it is in some respects new.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.